afternoon, I want to take off my mask and invite my guests to do so as well. Here we are in Yom Kippur afternoon at Road of Sholem. We have a tradition of spending part of our afternoon reflecting on the themes that we've either been discussing or giving us an opportunity to return to some conversations that we've taken up recently. This time a year ago, as we were just 6 months or so into the pandemic, we had experienced a summer that had been tumultuous across the country, all kinds of protests, all kinds of different events that made national news. The terrible and brutal killing of George Floyd, which set off a cascade of events in Pittsburgh and Minneapolis and in cities all over the country. And we came to appreciate that there were now truths that many of us who might otherwise have been able to deny we weren't aware of them, or were able to imagine that they weren't as significant as some might have said or suggested that they were, there was now a reality that none of us could deny. We began to scratch some of those conversations and some of those issues, and we wanted to make sure, Rabbi Henry and I, that we didn't leave them in last year, but that we continued to carry them forward. I feel very fortunate to be able to introduce to you one of my newest friends. Dr. Asa Lee is the new president of the Pittsburgh Theological Seminary in Highland Park. He and his family, his wife and their four daughters, have moved to Pittsburgh from the Washington, D.C. area, where Dr. Lee was at Wesley Theological Seminary. He's an unusual candidate, if you will, for the presidency of Pittsburgh Theological Seminary because his denominational training is in the Baptist tradition. He's an unconventional candidate as an African-American, and also at 41 years old is probably the younger president in the history of your school.
Youngest.
Youngest. Well, good for you and good for Pittsburgh. We came to know each other just in the last few weeks as Dr. Lee's been making the rounds and meeting folks in Pittsburgh, and I was eager to extend a hand of friendship also. So I was taken with the fact that in our early conversations, Dr. Lee, we spoke of that the COVID pandemic both exposed and accelerated and probably also exacerbated realities that were already very much underway. Mm-hmm. And so now we're responding, or we're challenged to respond to something that we'd either had willful blindness about, a term we'll come back to later, or we simply were able to, exist in our little bubbles and not have to deal with other realities that were uncomfortable. Help us appreciate what you've seen in the last 18 months and what hope you bring to Pittsburgh in the position you have.
Thank you, Rabbi. Let me say thank you for the opportunity to share both last night in service as well as to be a part of this conversation. It is a privilege and a joy to be with you all today to talk about a level of responsibility that we all carry if we're going to be in community one with another. The last 18 months have, I heard one friend say it like this, particularly May, June of 2020, and the summer that followed, all of us were exposed to what it means to be African American in America. And if you recall, it wasn't just American cities, it was a global, right? I remember vividly in the UK, there were toppling Churchill statues and wrestling with colonial legacies there. And so it provides us the opportunity, the last summer provided us an acute opportunity to say, what have our neighbors been experiencing that we have not taken stock of? How have our neighbors lived in a world and navigated challenges, and how were we not aware of them? And then, at least for my conversation partners serving in an institution in Washington, D.C. that was predominantly a white institution, but wrestling in the same way that all white institutions were wrestling with, what is then the collective responsibility? How do we engage our neighbors in what's going on? How do we listen? And then how are we changed in the listening? And so I have experienced conversations with new partners and long-held partners that have been 10 or 15 years in the making, right? I didn't know this was happening. That was the refrain. And my counter was, you did. You just didn't pay attention.
Right.
It was happening in front of our eyes. And there were reasons for that, you know, maybe we can delve into. But we have an opportunity to continue the dialogue now.
You know, I said that I thought something similar was happening. I made reference to it last evening, early in the pandemic, when the fear was, certainly among the privileged white Jewish folks in Squirrel Hill, that when the news of the pandemic began to really sink in, and there was a potential that one might require medical care and you'd receive it in a parking garage mm-hmm. without a ventilator, mm-hmm. it got real. Mm-hmm. But when there were 12 million people who didn't have health care, we were able to sort of consider that a rounding error,
yeah.
or understand that in big, with big numbers, things like that happen.
Yeah.
But when we realize that we might actually be a victim, or we might be African American,
right.
or we might suffer the fate of the poor or the vulnerable, we had a different response.
Yeah. COVID has, and I think you said it eloquently last night, COVID has reminded us of our mortality, but also has shown that human life is ultimately, death is the ultimate equalizer, right? And COVID does not care about any of the ways in which we classify ourselves, right? It's always equalizer. But it also exposed to us just how acute something like healthcare is a determiner, access to it, ability to navigate it. Those are determiners of your position in the society.
Right.
Right. If you are accustomed to annual checkups, 6 month dental visits, annual eye, you know, other kinds of normal screenings, then in this society, you are of a certain class.
Right.
If most of your healthcare comes from a CVS pharmacy or an urgent care clinic or comes at the expense of I can't afford that, so I'll have to do this. If that's your norm, then you are in this society of a different class. And that's an American phenomenon, right? Because in other parts of the country, of the world, that is not the norm. And so the COVID reality exposed for us yet and still another determiner of class and how we wrestle with that in this country.
You know, that was brought home to me when we were introduced to the term essential workers, uh-huh. but we meant the folks who get paid hourly,
yeah.
right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And can't afford not to be at work, or yeah. upon whom we all depend, but just don't see them day to day, typically.
Yeah, you say that. I remember May of 2020, as we were all saying, how is this? It's going to be a few more months and we'll be fine, right? We were all back then saying, it's been a long time, but everything's going to be okay. I was in a similar dialogue with a pastor who framed this in a wonderful way. He said, you know, what we've learned is, we said before the pandemic that essential workers were, you know, the decision maker up here or the operations manager and all that. But what we discovered was that school bus drivers were essential workers.
Right.
And grocery store clerks were essential workers.
Right.
Right. And we did not conceive of them as being essential workers. So then if that's the case, what kind of pay do essential workers
right.
get? What kind of benefits ought essential workers have? Those are the, it shifted this whole conversation.
There's no question. And while you point out that COVID makes no distinction between ethnicity or race or the different variables that we are so ready to identify folks at, it is the case, right, that we know that this particular disease or this particular contagion, and then we can see others do hit certain populations with an overrepresentation because of the way in which our society is structured.
Precisely.
Right? Because of the housing or because of the transportation or because of the factors that we don't otherwise consider as
right.
healthcare determinative.
Right.
But in point of fact, they are.
Right. Right.
Actually, we spoke, you and I, briefly about the concept in Yom Kippur tradition, in Jewish tradition, of what we refer to as a cheshbon ha-nefesh, an accounting mm-hmm. of our soul.
Mm-hmm.
We take stock of the country. We take stock of the world. We find it rather easy to point our finger at those groups or those entities that are frustrating outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
So we pick on the media. We pick on this political party or that political party or the politicians, all of them,
yeah.
right? But ultimately, we know that change starts with each of us
mm-hmm.
and that we have that responsibility,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Aware that there are now things that we can't pretend we aren't aware of or we can no longer ignore, and of our human propensity to convince ourselves of anything we want to convince ourselves of, or to ignore anything that is inconvenient or discomforting enough that we'd rather not deal with it. How do we approach what responsibility each of us has?
That is the question, right? It is a moral and ethical question that all of us face. I would start with recognizing that none of us live in systems, right? We talk about systems all the time and how they operate, but we are all relational beings. We operate on an individual basis by choices and decision makings that start with us. And so the question becomes, when realities are happening, when things are happening, how am I either insulated? How are the decisions that I'm making participating in or resisting or engaging what's happening in the world? For a lot of us, what happened to George Floyd in Minneapolis was so far removed and so far away from what was going on in our life that what does this have to do with me? But then when someone we interact with every day tells the story of their own experience,
right,
of even in a place like Pittsburgh, especially in a place like Pittsburgh, right, when those stories start to come alight, you're not as insulated as you thought you were. And then you have a decision to make. So what I found is, here I am, an educated African-American male, I am a pastor, I have pastoral experience, I'm an educator, I don't fit the mold of the stereotypes that often go along with a lot of these police encounters. So when you hear me say, I've been profiled, mm-hmm. I have been pulled over and asked, what am I doing in this neighborhood at this hour of the night? I've been asked, why am I driving this car? Mm. When you hear that from someone like me, in a space that actually transcends some of the other class distinctions that happen that can insulate, then it's closer than you think.
Right.
And then the question becomes, what can I do? How are my decisions affecting what's going on? And what I've enjoyed about conversation and relational conversation is that the easiest thing to do is actually listen. Listen to what folks have said. Mm-hmm. I did a panel. It was very, very prescient. The panel was in January of 2020, mm-hmm. right? When everything was just fine.
It's the good old days,
right? And it was a panel on religious freedom and the African American community. So we're talking about the First Amendment, and it was a very diverse panel. It was really great. And one of the persons in the audience, a white woman, after we discussed sort of race and racism and how it was manifesting in this country and how some of the things that had long been in America's closet had come out as a result of the previous presidential administration and other factors, she said, well, what can we do? What can I as a white woman do to help? And this panel that was diverse ignored the question and kept talking about other things. So someone else, another white person, asked the question. She asked the question. We ignored it again. Uh-huh. The third time was the white woman that was on the panel said, there was a question asked twice. We didn't. And so in a moment of vulnerability, I answered the question. I said, you know why we ignored that question? Because the simple truth of the matter is what you can do is listen. Black and brown people in this country for years have been saying that there were police deaths before George Floyd.
Sure.
Right? There were incidences of race and racism happening long before the summer of 2020. And folks protested, folks marched, folks spoke out, people tried to have legislation. No one listened. So when you say, what can we do? We ignored the question because you know what to do, uh-huh. but you haven't done it. And so for us now is when we're faced with these close-in realities, we all have decisions to make. And I think the first question we always must ask ourselves is, what am I going to do? Not every person is going to get up and march. I'm the first one to advocate that everybody has a role in the movement. It's not all the same role. My choice, I'm not marching. I'm not getting up and going into the street. Why? I don't need an arrest record. You know, and I say that jokingly, but also a little seriousness in I'm not getting arrested. But what I will do is support those who feel called to that work. So if my gift is to go find bail money, which I've done, then that's what I'll do. If my gift is to help paint, make posters, then that's what I'll do. If my gift is to be in the room where decisions happen, to help people make different decisions and represent voices that otherwise aren't, then that's what I'll do. But the choice has to be yours and has to start with the information that you have. What influence can I give to the group? I really don't like those who give a zero-sum game. If you're not in the street, you're not a part of the movement. And I've been in the room with those kind of activists. I said, well, who's going to bail you out when you get arrested? Got to have somebody to write the check. Oh, I didn't think about that. Well, no, you didn't, but I did. So right. Let's work together to figure this thing out.
So there's a couple of thoughts. One is there's rabbinic teaching which suggests it's sort of acute and it's glib, but it speaks to the need to listen, that God created us with one mouth and two ears so that we'd listen twice as much as we speak.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The other is the phrase, ein kemach ein Torah, without flour or without bread, money even. There's no Torah. There's no learning, right? We need both. We need people in the street, people who will support them. We need people who will be the scholars, and we need people who will donate to seminaries and universities.
That's correct.
Right? All of that is true. I'm thinking of how often we, to make a distinction between hearing something and listening, right? We hear something and we immediately get defensive.
Yeah.
Or we immediately figure out, well, what can I say that will justify what took place? Rabbi Henry, my colleague, often tells me that in these kinds of conversations, I find that I am defending the wrong person. My first reaction is, well, how can we justify that person so that person wasn't intentionally doing the wrong thing? There must have been circumstances. Or can we give them the benefit of the doubt? Or I react in a way that suggests, well, I'm not racist.
Right.
So I want you to say, if you just say a little bit more with regard to what we do with listening, having heard what you have to say, now what do we do with that?
Yeah, my grandmother used to say, you hear me, but you're not listening.
Right.
So you heard words, but you didn't process what those words mean. So when we listen, we're not listening to be, and this is something that we've lost in our public discourse. We often listen to argue, to debate. Where's the key point that I can point out that you're wrong, or that you are discredited, or, you know, to undermine in a tit for tat model? But listening, it requires sitting in tension with what you're hearing versus your own reality, right?
Sometimes we call that listening to understand.
Yes, and the understanding is not just the person, but understand what is happening to you when you hear this. And I've had to sit in places where I am diametrically opposed to the viewpoint of another person, but for the sake of community and living with that person, I must sit and wrestle with not just what they're saying, but how I am responding to what they're saying.
That's fascinating.
Right? So if I am getting defensive, why am I getting defensive? What is it that's happening? And if I'm really vulnerable, I may say to that person, I'm feeling defensive and here's why.
My therapist says to me all the time, so what's going on with you, right? You just said these things, or you've heard me respond, and sort of how are you embodying that, right? I see that you're tense, or right, whatever it is.
Yeah.
So listening for what's being said, and before responding, certainly, listening for the still small voice within.
Yes, and the conviction that may happen as a result of that, and being willing to recognize that the person in front of you is not convicting you, but the truth of what the person is saying is convicting, and if so, why, right? And when I've done racial conversations, those conversations are very tense, as some of you may know. They get really, really, but they're most helpful when you're able to allow for recognition that this person's reality is their truth.
Right.
And it is not your responsibility to judge that or to defend your truth in relationship to theirs. Right? In many cases, we already recognize that our lives are different. Okay, let me explore that difference with you in a way that that is helpful. I'll give you an acute example. I was asked to be a convener and a consultant with a local fire department in Virginia on issues and matters of race. And we started something that I think and I pray is continued. We called it Firehouse Conversations. And the topic was the station house would go offline for 90 minutes, and they'd pull up chairs, and these firefighters would sit around and talk about very specific instances of race. What happened? How do they happen? How do we deal with them collectively? But we didn't talk about race. We talked about very personal questions. What is your experience in the fire department? How did you? And when I started this work, I said, these are firefighters. They're brave. They can do just about anything. They know how to charge. And one of the captains said, you know, Doc, let me tell you, we're taught how to run into a building that's on fire and get everybody out and all that. We're not taught soft courage, what they call soft courage, which is to sit down and have a conversation with each other. So what we'll do is we'll work together on the fire, and then we'll be at each other's throats at dinner about something, because we don't know how, we're not taught the other side of this. And so he said, Doc, what we got to learn how to do is teach each other how to listen, how to talk to each other, and gently sort of live together with one another, because our lives actually do depend on it, not just in the fire, but also if we're going to live together.
Right. So there's a French Jewish philosopher named Emmanuel Levinas who describes the commanding presence of the other. Mm-hmm. That when you look into another person's face, you're seeing a visage of God, and there's a commanding presence that you're being compelled, right, as you see, look into another human being's face. And when we can see someone as a human being who has a lived experience and has a truth that may be incredibly painful or discomforting to hear about, particularly if we live on another side of the world with regard to the concerns that we have day to day.
Right, right.
But if we can listen and appreciate that story has, it's compelling, right? It has a claim on us.
And you're not the same as a result. And for me, those are moments of encounter with God, right? To pick on Levinas a little bit. I must say the most diverse room I had ever been a part of in my entire life was a part of these firehouse conversations in which we went to the cadet training center. And there were 23 or 24 new recruits learning how to be firefighters. There was a demographic representation of every single box you can imagine. That space of just listening and dialoguing with one another was so transparent and vulnerable that in that space, a trans man came out in that space.
Wow.
Felt safe enough to do that. Several folks talked about deep personal hurts of overcoming addiction. I mean, things that are deep spaces of vulnerability. That space of just simply listening and responding in ways that affirm one another without judgment in a room in which every single person came from some sort of different reality was, and I said to myself, here I am, a theological educator, a pastor for a number of years, but I have to go to a firehouse to have an ultimate experience of the divine at work in people's lives.
Right, when you least expect it.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
I know that, at least from the printed bios after your appointment, that your work in diversity, equality, inclusion, as well as collaboration, you have a vision for what you want to bring to the next generation of faith leaders. And it's no accident that you were selected with the vision that you have, with the generational perspective that you have, with the racial perspective and experiences that you have. What is it that you hope to bring to the seminarians who are coming to Pittsburgh to study at PTS? And what can we learn on this Yom Kippur Day with regard to an ecumenical sense of where we hope to take this community, this country, and our world?
Yeah, so, you know, I'm excited to join Pittsburgh Seminary at a time in which theological education is wrestling with, if I were to say it in a single word, relevance. Like many of our religious institutions in America, the way in which religious life participates in public life is being diminished, being transformed, being relegated, being devalued or being segregated to particular political viewpoints. And so there is a need, however, and I firmly believe that there is a place and a role for not just one perspective on theology, but a multitude of perspectives on the issues facing us today in the public square for theological institutions. In theological education, which is a sort of a niche of higher education, a very small niche of higher education, the struggle is amongst Protestants how we fuel and sustain the life of Christian denominations and Christian churches. What I hope to bring to PTS, though, is a recognition that the Christian church and the congregation is but one way in which religious life participates in the public square. There are many people who come to seminary who don't feel called to a pulpit ministry. They feel called to nonprofit or community engagement or community rehabilitation or ways in which eco-theology and eco-care and creation care are all intertwined. You have folks who are second career who are lawyers but want to do a different part of their skill sets and offer them in a different way. And the seminary is the place where that can be resourced and fueled to do new and exciting things. And what I love about Pittsburgh Seminary is all of the previous generations who fueled and built the seminary, both its financial resources as well as its legacy here in Pittsburgh, built a solid foundation for which we can then explore what does it mean to be faithful to your commitments of understanding of theology and how do you live that out. And there are a lot of ways in which that can happen, whether that's urban ministry through the Metro Urban Institute here at PTS, or the Center for Adaptive and Innovative Ministry, which looks at how are you doing creative things in ministry. We have a Center for World Mission Initiatives that looks at how do we effectively and healthily participate in mission work around the world. And, oh, by the way, there's a lot of mission work you can do right in your own backyard as a part of this and not replicate the negative effects of years gone by. And so there's a way in which all of that can happen at PTS, and Pittsburgh as a city, as I've come to learn, is got a little bit of everything going on. And so there are ways in which the public square can use a more concerted voice of religious thinkers, leaders, and practitioners, both from the Christian perspective, but also how do we do that ecumenically across all of the faith traditions here in Western PA. So, you know, that's a very high level of what I hope to do. But I also add that as a part of that work, it means dismantling our participation in systems that have been oppressive over the years. And that means we have to take a close look at ourselves,
right,
as Christian communities that our hard looks at ourselves, and that's difficult, but we have to acknowledge that we hurt people,
right,
over time.
So this is obviously a conversation taking place in the country as well. Mm-hmm. When I spoke about the distinction I make between traditions and habits,
yes,
traditions being the essentials of what it is that we're about, and the habits are how we go about them.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm,
for instance, in medicine, the traditions are patient care, relieving suffering, do no harm, and the habits are the medicine man, the Marcus Welby, making house calls, HMOs, PCPs,
right,
insurance,
right,
how doctors are trained, cyber medicine, telehealth, right?
Right.
Those,
right,
are habits. And that if we focus on our traditions, we'll learn new habits.
Correct.
If we focus on preserving our habits, how we do it now, we're dead in the water.
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
And so clearly religion will go about its work in different ways, but the traditions are the essential pieces,
correct,
right? Recognizing in every person the
dignity
of God, created,
yeah,
in the image of God,
mm-hmm,
listening to those stories,
mm-hmm,
ascribing to everyone the same breadth of emotion that we would claim for ourselves.
Right, right,
right. We have a,
right,
wonderful prayer in our service that says, when will redemption come when we accord to everyone that which we would expect for ourselves, right? I wonder if you could leave us on this day when we're spending much of the day being self-reflective, but yes, the problems in the systems, but really appreciating that that change starts with me.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
G.K. Chesterton famously replied in response. He was an 19th century British theologian who was asked one time, what's the greatest problem with religion? And his response was, I am. Right? And then at some level, that's true for each and every one of us. We have a wonderful tradition, depths that we can turn to, right? But if we don't access them or we don't believe and live them out, I wonder what you would leave us with on Yom Kippur Day, but how we each can be more of who we were created to be.
Yeah, so, I've used that traditions and habits several times with proper citation related to helping people understand change, right? I think for us, and I speak for my own tradition as a Christian, the fundamentals of our teachings have to do with neighborliness and a recognition in the same way that what happens, I always should be concerned not just what happens to me, but what happens to the one who is my neighbor. And neighbor is a broad definition of what that looks like. And so as we wrestle with the self-reflection, how is my neighbor's experience different than my own? Why? And not that my experience needs to be my neighbor's, but how do I wrestle with the distance between the two so that we in fact have a better lived experience together? For if my neighbor is being blessed in many ways, then surely the blessing is also mine in many respects. I was in eastern Washington State, far from Washington, D.C., far from the East Coast, sitting in a barbecue joint, complete with cowboy hats and the whole nine. And I was the only, besides the cooks, I was the only African-American patron in the store, in the restaurant. And there sitting at a table, in the bar area, some folks came up, some regulars came up, and they struck up a conversation with me. And we proceeded to talk for the next 3 hours. They had never really lived outside of that town. They had never experienced any well-dressed African-American. The minority in the community were Latinx persons who worked in the fruit orchards of Eastern Washington. And what they began to quiz me on at first were the, it's the only way I can describe it, sort of the talking points of conservative media about police interactions and black people in America and these kind of things. And one by one, I dismantled each one of those. Not because I had some other counter talking point, but simply when they asked a vulnerable question like, well, how many, did you go to college? Yes. Well, did you graduate? Yes. Did you, right? And they went down this whole list of things. And then when they said, have you ever been arrested? I said, no. Have you ever been pulled over by the police? Absolutely. There, you could see bit by bit their minds were blown. So then by the time that conversation was over, in this one little interaction, they had some decisions to make about the truth they were telling themselves, right? Because at the end of the day, they had to now walk away saying, no matter what, they met a man who was not like the stereotype.
Right.
And therefore, I cannot say anymore all and all and all. And I think the more that we listen to each other and the more that we are willing to actually be changed by the encounters we have, which is what part of, I believe, is an encounter with God is designed to do and what Levinas is getting at. And if you are willing to be open to the other being present in someone, then the possibility for you to be different,
right,
and to be self-reflective and to then be caring for your neighbor is made more available to you. It's still your choice, but it's more available to you.
So I know that our time is short and we'll have many opportunities to continue talking, but if the one takeaway is the importance of being willing to listen with an open heart, to not be quick to make the response or the retort or to give the rebuttal, but just to sit with another person and their truth.
Yes.
Then we'll go a long distance towards appreciating what we have in common and what we can accomplish together.
Amen.
I look forward to many more conversations. I'm so grateful for your being with us last night and sharing part of this afternoon.
Yes, absolutely.
I wish you much success and look forward to sharing in that.
Thank you so much, and I'm glad to be here.
Terrific. We wish you a good year for your family as well and your community of health, happiness, prosperity, and peace.
And you as well, and to the congregation. Blessed year.
Thank you. Thank you so much.